you for this crowd this morning. Lord, I thank you for those who are coming to sing here shortly. Lord, I thank you for our choir, our praise team. I thank you for our deacons, our Sunday school teachers, our members, Lord. Just thank you for their faithfulness. And Lord, I thank you for this opportunity to come to worship in your house. Lord, I pray that you're honored and glorified in everything that we do. Lord, I pray for a revival tonight. Lord, I pray that you lift Brother Steve up, protect him, hide him behind the cross each day. Lord, I pray that hearts and minds will be pointed and directed towards you. And I pray their hearts and minds will be softened and receptive to the Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that lives changed and lives renewed and lives restored this week. Lord, I thank you for all your many blessings. Lord, I thank you for loving us. I thank you for dying on the cross. In your precious heavenly name I pray. Amen.
Moving in honest, I worship you. and worshiping the Lord. To hear those precious, innocent voices lifting their voices to the Lord is moving. I want to ask everybody to quote with me. I'm sure most everybody in here can quote John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Amen. That's the gospel right there. So please stand with us as we sing about what Jesus did for us on the cross at Calvary.
Changes not thy compassion. thank you for the worship that we've already had, Father. We thank you for the children's choir, how we were blessed by them, Father. Father, it's so good to see small faces around our church. Father, such a blessing to us, and we just thank you for them. Father, as we come to this time in service, we ask that you bless the gift and the giver, and we ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Stand right now and greet those around you and let them know how happy you are to see them this morning.
Thank you, Jesus.
Well, amen. If you have your Bibles, I want you to turn to the book of John, John chapter number 11. We're going to be looking at 10 verses this morning, verses 17 through 27. Heard a story about a 95-year-old lady in a small town, and she had recently gotten married for the fourth time. And so the local newspaper caught wind of it through her church that she had been married for the fourth time at 95. So the reporter from the news kind of wanted to come and talk to her, and he said, "Ma'am, that's a very intriguing story. You got married for the fourth time at 95. He said, "Can you tell me a little bit about your life?" And she told him that when she was in her 20s, she married a banker, and that marriage kind of filtered out. And in her 40s, she married a guy that had come when the circus had come to town, and he was a ringmaster. And so she married him, and of course, he was gone all the time. So that marriage fizzled out. And in her late 60s, she finally married a pastor, and that marriage somehow fizzled out. And finally, this fourth marriage was in her 90s to a funeral director. And she said, that reporter looked at that lady and she said, "Well, ma'am, I've got to admit, before I even write down anything, that is four guys that just seem to have nothing in common." She said, can you tell me at least a correlation, something in common with these guys?" And she said, "Sure. I married one for the money, two for the show, three to get ready, and four to go." You know what's funny? That don't even fit in my sermon nowhere. I just wanted to share that with y'all this morning. That one got me a little bit too. Our text this morning is from a familiar account for most of us. It deals with a very difficult moment in the lives of those who were very close to Jesus. And it's also a difficult moment for those who are close to Jesus now. And as the Lord ministered in the area in Jerusalem that we know about, He often visited the home of Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, their brother. These three had developed a close and endearing relationship with Jesus. They had broke bread. They had spent time with each other. And although these people were very close to the Lord, their lives were not free of heartache and despair. And let me start off by getting serious here for just a moment. Sometimes we miss that. We miss that truth. That even though we're close to God, even though we do everything, we're saved by His wonderful grace. We worship in His house. We surround ourselves with His people. We get into His word. And we do everything, but yet we're still not free from heartache and despair. It will come our way. In fact, Lazarus had suddenly died while Jesus was away. Though the death of a dear friend, Jesus would perform one of His greatest miracles while teaching eternal truth in the midst of a season of pain for this family. And let me say something else. When you're in pain, He knows. And He can speak during your pain. If you'll just let Him speak. Listen, folks, when you are in pain, that is prime opportunity for Jesus to show up. You've got to invite Him in, though. He wants to help you. He knows you're hurt. Even no matter how severe it is. And I know death has come to all of our families at one point in time. That is a truth that we're going to face until the rapture takes place or we all go by the grave. So it's a truth that we're just going to have to face. And it's a truth that we as Christians tend to kind of ignore until that day. And I'm not saying you got to be morbid and say, "Hey, Pastor, how are you? Well, how are you doing today?" And, "Well, I'm just waiting to die, you know. I don't want you to do that on me, you know." Even though where we're going is a glorious place. Amen? Amen? But I just want you to know that during your pain, during your season of pain that you or your family are in, He can still work a miracle. Yes, so if you're able, would you please stand for the reading of God's Word, John chapter 11. I'm going to start in verse 17 and go to verse 27. And the Bible says in John 11, verse 17, "Then when Jesus came, He found that He had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off, and many of the Jews came to Martha to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him. But Mary, don't pay attention to this, Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. Martha saith unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Then Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? Posed a question to her. Do you believe this? Do you believe what I just told you? In verse 27, she saith unto him, yep, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. So tonight, or this morning, we're going to talk about Jesus when he says, I am the resurrection and the life. Amen. Let's pray. Lord, we love you. Lord, just thank you for that great music. Thank you for those kids. Just thank you for the faithfulness and the Holy Spirit in this place, Lord. I thank you for dying on the cross. And Lord, I just pray you'll just bless these next few moments. Lord, I pray that they don't see me, they see you. I pray, Lord, anytime we do anything that they don't see us, they see you. I pray, Lord, that my words become your words and my thoughts become your thoughts. And I pray this prayer in the holy name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. A few years ago in New Mexico, a family had puppies. And they sold all the puppies off that the mom and the male and the female dog had. And they kept one of the puppies and named him Brownie. Brownie got out of the yard one Saturday afternoon. And like all good animals, he went exploring. But unfortunately, Brownie ventured out onto the street and got hit by a passing car. The family tearfully buried that little puppy in their backyard, and come the next day, they all got in the car and drove to church. When they got home, they found that the other dog, Brownie's mom, refused to believe he was dead, so she went out and dug him up. They saw Brownie lying on the back porch. He was all dirty and broken, but yet he was still breathing. To make a long story short, they took him to the vet, got him fixed up, and now they have since changed his tag from Brownie to Lazarus. So as we examine this passage this morning, we'll discover that the Lord working in a miraculous way, a way to meet an immediate need. But the greater lesson revealed to us is one of eternal value and implication, one that we can use. Jesus has the ability to provide for our immediate needs. But he also has the ability to secure our eternal destination. Of the I am statements we have considered thus far, this one, I think, is the greatest. I want to discuss this morning the aspects as we consider him, the resurrection and the life. The first thing we see is the devastation that they experienced. We see that in verses 17 through 20. They reveal that the devastation that Mary and Martha had experienced with the death of their brother Lazarus. Look at verses 17 through 18. Then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. We see the context. We know from the preceding chapter that Jesus had spent some time near the Jordan River prior to the death of Lazarus. And having received news that Lazarus was sick and close to death, he decided to stay 2 more days. First gut reaction. Why? He could have healed him. Sure. But see, what we don't understand sometimes is that Jesus sees beyond what we see. He knew what was about to take place. He knew what he was going to do. So a greater miracle was about to be performed. After 2 days had passed, Jesus told the disciples to let's prepare and return to Judea. He affirmed that Lazarus was dead before they departed to return to Bethany. While the situation was very desperate for Mary, Martha, and really Lazarus at this time, Jesus had purposely waited for his return. After it seemed that all hope was lost, Jesus started toward Bethany to deal with their situation. Folks, there are times in our life when it seems that we've passed a point of no return. It seems like we just have gone too far. We assume our situation will never improve and may even think that the Lord has chosen to do nothing for us. You may be sitting here going, I don't think the Lord even remembers my address. But listen, he is still walking towards you if you're in response to him and welcome him in. He will still head your way if you cry out to him this morning. And we'll soon find out that Jesus is never late. Even after 4 days. Following a situation that is extreme as death. You're like, that's the final chapter. That's it. That's it. He can't do nothing else. That's beyond death. But folks, we need to understand that he works beyond our comprehension. He conquered death, hell, and the grave. So what did we think? What do we think when this happens to us that he hadn't figured it out? He knows that we're hurting. He knows what we need. And yet he has the situation under control if we let him. Look at verse 19. We see the concern. And many of the Jews came to Mary and Martha to comfort them concerning their brother. It was evident that Mary, Martha, and Lazarus were loved by many. We find that many who knew, and by the way, this is a good verse for how the church is supposed to act when somebody's hurting. The community came and ministered to them. Amen. It didn't say the pastor. It didn't say all the staff came, which we're supposed to. It said that the community came. Folks, what's our immediate community? Yes, it's Liberty. It's Easley. It's Pickens. It's 6 miles north. Maybe even Pattersville and Greenville. Listen, folks, our community right now is Eastside Baptist Church. When one hurts, we should all hurt. We find that many who knew them came to comfort the grieving sisters and offer their condolences. There was nothing they could do to bring Lazarus back. But they were there just to offer comfort. Clearly, we're limited in our ability to bring a solution to many problems our friends and family face. The majority of us have faced a similar situation, having lost a loved one in death. While we're unable to change the situation or even remove their grief and pain, we can just be there for them and offer comfort in their difficult times. One of the greatest acts of kindness we can offer is simply our presence in a time of despair. Me and Brother Randy went to go visiting Thursday. Visit a lady in our church who battles dementia. She had Randy read a card about 8 different times, didn't she? I bet Randy could have recited it by the time we left. But you know what? She just got so tickled that we were just spending time with her. She got so tickled that we would just take time out of our busy schedule. And I'm amazed by that because it's really humbling because it's like, you take time out of my busy schedule. As a pastor, I guess you can get too busy doing things you think are important, but really meeting your members and meeting your constituents should be on your prime target list to stuff you do each week. And folks, we're just not doing that during the day. We've already got a plan implemented that we're going to come in the evening. So go ahead and get your house clean. We're not giving you notice. We're going to show up, go ahead and wipe them baseboards down, and start mopping, start cleaning, because me and Randy's coming. So, because we understand some of y'all do work, and during the day is not an option. But we're going to come in the evening. And folks, listen, it's just saying that your leadership at your church cares. And that's not an indictment against anybody in our association or any other pastor in our association. That's not an indictment against anybody. I think one of the greatest things I can do as a pastor, or what me and another deacon can do as leadership of this church, is sit on your couch. Because being there means more than you realize. Hearing their story, I heard some fabulous stories from Miss Martha the other day. Had some great stories of her and Norman, and just what a blessing that was. It's just time, folks. Then we see the confusion. Look at verse 20. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary still sat in the house. Here we go. Here we find that an interesting and kind of a little bit confusing. As word came to the home that Jesus was on the way, Martha went to meet him. As he came, this is not unusual. Martha was hurting and grieving the loss of her brother. What is unusual is that Mary did not accompany her. And symbolically and spiritually right here, folks, we see one of two reactions when something bad happens here. Look, one, we look at it like Martha, running to Jesus, waiting on him to show up and do something marvelous and miraculous in our life, expecting him to do it. Or now we have Mary sitting in the house pouting, going, I'm saved. I should not have to go through this. So we have one of two reactions, folks. And listen, that's church members. You see right here, church hurt. You can look at it, dissect it all you want to, but you can see church hurt right here. I was walking with the Lord. I'm not now. I don't even want to see him because something happened in my life that I didn't like. Yeah. Folks, there's going to be things in our life that we don't understand, that we don't like. We have to understand that it's an opportunity for the Lord Jesus Christ himself to show up in a mighty way. That's why we look at it. That's how we need to look at it. Mary's the one who was always found to be near Jesus. And now she's nowhere to be found. However, in this moment of intense grief and pain, she chose to stay at the house instead of going to meet Jesus. This reveals a valuable truth that we should consider this morning. Even the strongest believers struggle at times when faced with a devastating situation. And there's no sugarcoating that. I'm sure we've all been there. We all struggle with a devastating situation. This does not imply that Mary had abandoned her faith in the Lord, but it does appear she had resigned to defeat. And folks, we can resign ourselves to defeat if we continue listening to the devil. We can say, hey, we defeated. It don't get no better than this. Life just, I'm just going to do what... and we stay a defeated life. I don't think our Savior, Jesus Christ, wants us to live a defeated life. I think we're victorious when we believe in him. Amen? Amen? We understand that Mary's world was shattered and she's having difficulty coping with the reality of her situation. You almost feel for Mary and you feel for those who are just in dire situations that just don't seem one that they walked into purposefully, one that just kind of fell in their lap. We all face times when our faith is tested and we're tempted to resign to defeat. But folks, he's still on the throne. He still cares. He knows you by name. He still loves you. Then we see a conversation in verses 21 through 24. Here we discover there's a conversation between Martha and Jesus as he made his way to Bethany. We see a complaint. Look at verse 21. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if thou hast been here, my brother had not died. I don't think Martha intended any disrespect here, but her frustration and disappointment seem clear. She declared unto Jesus that Lazarus would not have died had he made it to Bethany sooner. Boy, she's about to see something, isn't she? While we do see her faith in the Lord, knowing he was more than able to provide, we also see her despair. And folks, he could have just snapped his fingers, and where he was at, he could have healed Lazarus. From where he was, they could have praised, hey, and they did. Hey, heal my brother, snapped his fingers, whispered it in motion. He could have saved Lazarus. But he decided to wait and let their situation marinate on their behalf to see a greater miracle. See, folks, sometimes we got to understand that, yeah, we want God to move, but the miracle is going to happen down the way, and it's greater. Listen, folks, he was on his deathbed, having a fever, ever how sick he was. And all of a sudden, he just gets up, yawns, I'm kind of feeling a little bit better. I'll take some salmon stew and some ginger ale, if you don't mind, please. Throw some oyster crackers on there. And that'd have been a miracle in itself. But look at the greater miracle. Now they see this joker coming out of the grave after that. And by the way, when they moved the stone, there was a stink in the air, which was Lazarus himself. Why? He had been dead. Amen. So when they moved the stone, so what's the greater miracle? Him getting healed, coming up out of a bed, or him walking out of a tomb with grave clothes still on. See, folks, Jesus knows what's best for us. But we see a complaint. Well, while we do see her faith, we also see her despair. She was hurting from the physical loss and the emotional strain of losing her brother. And she wondered why the Lord had delayed and not come as she requested. She knew he could heal. Hey, why didn't you get here sooner? I know you could heal him. But she wanted him healed on her terms. Jesus wanted to heal him on his terms. See, folks, we want to compartmentalize and put Jesus in that capsule. Hey, God, I know you can move today, but I want you to do it on my terms and when I want you to. And he don't work that way sometimes. You know, we may tend to be critical of Martha, but we can be certain we've all felt the same way at some point in life. We've been faced with a difficult situation, desperately needing the Lord's help, and yet he doesn't seem to respond in the manner or time that we desire. Jesus, where are you at? I've been serving you. I've been serving you 25 years, and you still haven't shown up in that need. What if he was going to show up in year 26? Or 27. What if he was going to show up in year 25 in 2 days? And you just gave up on year 25? See, it's that stickability and that faithfulness. Amen. We kind of preach around right here. And no doubt we've all complained in situations about the Lord's response in time, and we're all guilty of it, including me. Lord, where are you at? Where are you at? Where are you at for them in that situation? Where are you at for this situation? But we can also have confidence. Look at verse 22. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou wilt ask of God, God will give it to thee. Although Martha was grieving and struggling with her faith, she remained confident in the Lord. She knew Jesus had the power and could secure whatever he desired. She was also confident of the truth of the resurrection, knowing death was not final for the believer. I said about this Wednesday night. Folks, when we die, those of us who are saved, we're going to really start living then. Oh, yeah. But in the midst of our sorrow here on earth, she remained confident in the Lord. Most of us have walked through valleys and faced great difficulty at some point in our life. And I don't want to be the bearer of bad news again, but we must realize that these difficult situations will continue as long as we live here. There will be time in life when it seems the Lord has failed to respond. We'll face grief. We'll face sorrow. We will stand at a crossroads in life, unsure of which direction to take. And these struggles accompany life, and we have to endure them. But we must be like Martha and remain confident in the Lord, even when faced with great difficulty, even when we can't see him coming down the way, even when we can see him, even when we think, Lord, you should have been here 4 days ago. Listen, folks, he may be 4 days late, but he's still on time. Right. You know, we face nothing that Jesus is unaware of or unable to handle. My mic go out. Let me say that one more time. We face nothing that our Lord is unaware of or unable to handle. We face the fact that he loves us with an everlasting love and has promised to never leave us or forsake us. In your moments, in our moments of doubt and despair, we can remain confident in the Lord, even when it appears that he's not near at that moment. Psalm 121, verses 1 through 2 say, I will lift up my eyes unto the hills, from whence cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord, which made heaven and earth. See, folks, sometimes we're the delay. Sometimes we're the delay because we kind of cry out and we cry out 100%. But we cry out 75 to Jesus and 25 to something else. We cry out 65% to Jesus and 35% of our own doing. And we don't truly give it at all. And that, folks, I think that constitutes sometimes our prayer life. You have a need in your life. You have a burden in your life. Do you share it in Sunday school? Number one, do you even come to Sunday school?
to share those burdens. Amen. Listen, folks, Sunday school around here is not going to be happy hour. It's not going to be social hour. There's a time allotted for maybe some breakfast, some socializing. But every Sunday school class around here better be getting in that word. Amen. And see, folks, we don't take advantage of that. And we don't say, hey, I got a need in my life. Share your burdens. That's the first group in Sunday school who will be at ground zero when your life crumbles. Or at least should be. And so we see, we don't give it to God. We don't give it to Jesus. We don't tell that Sunday school class because we might think they just think we're weird or we're in sin. They should be wrapping their loving arms around you, praying for that need. Don't let pride keep you away from God's blessings. Then we see a confirmation in verse 23. Jesus said, heard, thy brother shall rise again. Listen, folks, that's a miracle in itself, that what we read today, that what he's about to do. He raised Lazarus from the grave. I cannot. I've heard stories how somebody goes in for cancer treatment, stage 4, it's bad. Can't nothing we can do. Get scanned again, and it's gone. And the doctors go, huh, I don't know what happened. And more times than not, there was probably a lady or a guy who prayed. More times than not, there was a Sunday school class who prayed. More times than not, they're related to a good Bible-believing church that prayed. I know what happened. Jesus assured Martha, nothing to fear. Lazarus would rise again. See, folks, if your loved one is saved and they leave this world, tragic, tragic. And they're saved. The Bible says they're living better than we are. The Bible says they're in a better place than we are. They're really living. They had yet to make it to the tomb, and Martha assumed Jesus was referring to the resurrection. But there must have been comfort in these words. Death had invaded their home, but it would not be final. We are unable to comprehend the power and provision of God like Martha. Those who are saved believe in the resurrection, but we can rest in his sovereign care today. The Bible is filled with the promises from God, and we can be rest assured in each one of them if we allow them to move and work in our life. The Lord overcame every enemy that we will face, and because of his glorious resurrection, we can enjoy victory in this life and the life that is to come. Amen. Then a resurrection promise. Look at verses 25 through 27. We discover the hope promised through Jesus' power and resurrection. We see his preeminence. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. That should just make us want to do a little two-step right there. You know, even though we're Baptists, we can do a little two-step. Is that okay? Amen. Half y'all do it in the choir back here. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life. Who can bring resurrection than the one who conquered it? Death had come to their home, but he revealed hope. Death seemed final and brought great despair, but Martha stood in the presence of the one who had the power to provide resurrection, to provide life. Death was strong, but Jesus was stronger. You know, death is strong today. But the strength of our Jesus hadn't diminished. He still can overcome the power. We tend to respond in much the same way. We focus on the circumstances, but not the one who can change our circumstances. We're settled and confident in the power of the resurrection in the future, and yet often feel that he can still work in the present. We don't have to wait for something to transpire in the end. We can enjoy the rest. We can rest in his grace and provision today. I'm sure heaven will exceed our wildest expectations and our wildest dreams. But folks, we can have abundant life today. We can have a victorious life today. Don't let the devil beat you down and say your circumstances is all that you're going to endure. Don't listen to him. You start listening to the Lord. Amen. You let him work in you. Then we see a promise. I know what time it is. Verse the end of 25 and 26, he that believeth in me, though were dead, he shall live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Martha, you believe this? See, right now as we're getting close to that invitation time, that Holy Spirit's working on some, I hope, knocking. He said, hey, listen, if you believe in me, you're going to live forever. You're going to live forever in heaven with me. Do you believe this? Sir, do you believe this? Ma'am, do you believe this? Young lady, do you believe this? Young man, do you believe this? Jesus offers a great promise while challenging Martha to believe. Those who believe in Christ may die, but death will not be the end of their story. They will live again. In fact, those who believe in Christ never perish. They just change their address. To depart from this physical life is to enter the glorious presence of the Lord who has received Christ as our Savior. You know, we should be thankful to know the resurrection and life in a personal way. Folks, when you're saved, you know this same Jesus that had a conversation with Martha. You know this same Jesus that raised Lazarus from the grave. You know this same Jesus who rose himself out of the grave. Physical death may come to our body, but we can have the assurance of eternal life in Christ. Folks, those of us who are saved are promised by his grace life, not death. The saved by grace will live throughout eternity. Those who deny and reject him will face eternal death in a lake of fire. Jesus gives life today and forever. So as we close this morning, we see Martha went to tell her sister, Mary, Jesus has come and called on you. The resurrection life had come, and he was calling for Mary. The resurrection is calling for some this morning. You may be thinking to yourself, well, I'll just get saved tonight at revival. Listen, don't miss that blessing today. Listen, folks, I'm not trying to scare nobody. We see it all the time. You may not make it to revival. Why not nail it down? Take care of that situation right now. Why not get on that heavenly list? Get your name in that Lamb's Book of Life this morning. Why put it off? You done put it off long enough. Why not see a miracle happen right now? He's coming down the way. He's coming to Bethany. Are you running to him? He defeated sin, death, and hell over a weekend. And those of us who are saved by grace are promised eternal life. Have you done as Martha confessed that Jesus is Lord? Lord, I know what you promised. I know who you are. Or are you sitting here this morning going, I have no idea. If I die today, I don't know where I'm going. Folks, that happens. That happens. I don't know everybody's heart in here. I wish I had one of them machines that you could just tell me, yep, I just had a check or, you know. But I don't. You can't assume that everybody in your sanctuary is saved because, you know. Then where's the evangelistic part, you know. Then it comes discipleship part, and then you I guess you could go to discipleship and you don't see them being discipled, then you're thinking, well, maybe they are not saved. See how it works. Folks, I don't know what's inside your heart. I don't know what the Holy Spirit, I don't know if you're bored to death, you're about to fall asleep, or you can't wait to get to Stefano's here in a little while to go eat. But God's asking you to do something today. Holy Spirit's knocking, telling you, I don't know your life. I love sitting on people's couches because I get their perspective. I get what God brought them from, what God brought them to, and how they got to that moment where me and Brother Randy are sitting on their couch. Talking with Miss Patsy the other day. Husband's name was Tommy. You know, she calls him Tummy. Tummy's been gone a while. And so, but she could tell that she loved the kids, and she's, I can't wait to hear the kids. And yet her mind's kind of been diminishing a little bit. But she, Brother Randy was telling me what she would do in the church when she had all of her faculties. Why are you putting it off? Why are you putting it off? You may be thinking, well, maybe it's too late for me. Listen, wasn't too late for Lazarus. And Jesus was 4 days late in their mind, but he was on time in his time. You may be thinking, well, it's just too late for me. I don't know right now. I should have done that when I was sooner. It's just too late. Listen, folks, if you felt that yearning, if you felt that Holy Spirit talking to you, it's not too late. It will be one day when you come face to face with him and go, I didn't know. I didn't know what to do. Listen, you've heard the gospel as presented as clearly and plainly this morning. If you die and don't accept Jesus Christ as your Savior, you will end up in hell. But if you have Jesus in your heart, it's just not making a reservation in heaven. It's having that peace. It's having that moment, that those things that you need at the moment you need them in this life. Because he knows what we endure. And yet he's conquered them. And yet we still have folks who won't let him work in their life. You see they need Jesus. You see they need him to work in that situation. And yet they won't come down. They won't pray. They won't mention that prayer request. They won't talk to me. They'll just go by the wayside thinking it's too late. Well, folks, it's not. If you don't know him this morning, you can be resurrected and receive life this morning. Would you please stand and bow your head and close your eyes? Nobody looking around. If you read on past chapter, verse 27, it says that